creative greenhouse. Here we like to show our guests and show all the people here who come to visit Epcot the various different and innovative ways to grow plants using hydroponics. So these are pretty on the up and up, the newest ways to grow. All of our greenhouses are grown using hydroponics. So everything you see from here on out, we are growing without the use of soil. So no soil. We do use various other types of soilless media, but for the most part, that's it. So this system you guys see here on the conveyor belt, what I like to call it, or a track, is a very unique system, and that it is a subset of hydroponics called aeroponics. So it's not rooted in anything. The only support it is getting is from these metal rods that they are Velcro to. So they have Velcro strips we put on them. And in case you're wondering, the plant is a papaya. So they will just go along this conveyor belt, and when they go through the chamber inside is set up to where it has various different misting nozzles or mist jets that spray all the water and nutrients onto it, onto the roots that the plant would need. So the water is getting directly onto the roots. Plants are happy, we're happy, and very simple. So you guys are free to look into the chamber, so I know some of you already have. The squash was just continuing to grow off of it. Mm-hmm. And so we'll harvest it before it falls, hopefully. Yes. But we will see some papaya further on towards the end of the tour that are actually rooted in the ground. He is a sensitive plant, as Denise has pointed out. And so what he is exhibiting is a very unique plant characteristic called thigmotropism.
Is that why
he's moving? Are you closed up and untouched?
And so what thigmotropism is a plant's movement or response to touch or contact stimuli.
That's pretty awesome.
It could be. It's just a stimulus, though. It's a very huge controversy now. But so thigmotropism, people do this if there are very strong winds. They will also do it if a plant brushes up against it. Various other things. And also earthquakes!
Oh, that's cool. Look at that.
We had this in New Jersey, but then I never saw them in the wild. Yeah. So they grow very wild, more in tropical type regions. So I had a lady from the Republic of Panama who said that it was growing wild, it would just grow wild in her yard where she lives. So they also grow here in Florida as well. Is that a rhetorical question? Who doesn't like I must be crazy. I could have sworn I've had people on the tour before who said they didn't like the cucumbers.
I like cucumbers.
Alright. So if you guys want to continue on moving down this way so that way everyone can kind of gather around, they're seedless or what you would call a burpless variety. So the seeds are very small if there are any viable ones, and we can collect those.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. So it is much hotter and humid in these greenhouses, but it is our string greenhouse, as I mentioned before, so it's so called because of all the string that we use. So you can see across the canal and actually right over here at our Felicity cherry tomatoes, and we string a lot of our stuff up. As I mentioned before, you gain a lot of things, a lot of benefits by growing up vertically. One is higher crop yields in rock roll and coconut corn. So our blissy variety of tomato that we have right here is actually the exact same variety of our tomato tree. So this system over here is a more commercialized system. This is traditionally what you would see commercially. But our tomato tree is a very unique system, a very unique way of growing your tomatoes or growing a few other different vegetables and fruits. It produces much higher yield versus a much more efficient system. So, back in 2005-2006, we actually won a world record for harvesting the most tomatoes off of one tree within a year. We had a tomato tree that lasted over 16 months, produced over 32,000 tomatoes. And so that's about 1,200 pounds of them. And so we got a world record for that. This tree right here, amazingly, from seed, this one is a little over 7 months old. Or it's about 7 months from seed. So it is very, very large right now. So hopefully we can still keep it alive for quite a lot longer. I personally would love to beat our record. I think that would be fantastic. And it's just going to keep growing out over the trellis. So I'm sure you've noticed the spinning system over here. That is, we are just growing lettuces or other leafy greens in there. This system is unique in that you will not see it anywhere else in the world. It is only found here at the land at Epcot. So we're just growing lettuces. It is on the system, or the specific way that we are growing it, is by a system called NFT, which stands for Nutrient Film Technique. And if you come on down this way, I'll actually show you what a standard NFT system looks like. The standard NFT is grown on tables, as you guys will see over here. So we have four tables total. We have two over here on this side, and two over on the other side of the canal. And so it's a very efficient system. It's about a 4-week rotation. So from seed to the time we harvest, it's about 4 weeks. And so we are harvesting one table each week. And within the year, we will harvest 27,000 heads of lettuce that we can then send out to our restaurants here at the land. So the system is 24 hours. We have these gutters that we put everything in. We started everything out in rough wool. And we put little square holes in them so we can just put the rock wool seeds in there. And so it just opens up like so. It's like a standard gutter you would have on your house at home. And so, 24-hour system, we have max strength tubing that is just hooked up to it. Water's running constantly unless we're doing some kind of irrigation maintenance. And so another unique thing, if anyone's ever tried to grow lettuce before, you know it is a cool season or a cold season crop. Doesn't do really well in hot weather because it bolts or it flowers. So you get this giant stalk on it, has all these little flowers coming off of it. You're like, ooh, pretty, lettuce grows flowers. And your lettuce won't taste good after that. It's really inedible. And so what we have to do is we have to chill the water. So we chill it to about 70 degrees Fahrenheit. And so that way, whatever the water is recycled back up here, it comes through the chiller and all the other filters. And that way we can keep the lettuce in the water cold so it won't go and won't flower. And we can have really great tasting lettuce for our restaurants.
What are these things? What are these?
So these are cooling pads right here. And basically what it is like a corrugated cardboard that's been filled with other resins today, so that way it holds on real well. Because there's water that drips down all the way through. And as you can see, there are fans on the opposite side of the greenhouse that are then pulling that air through the water and through the material. And as it passes through the water, it's supposed to pull it down. So if you're standing fairly close to it, it's a lot cooler. Much cooler than if you're out here working in the sunlight. So it's supposed to cool the whole greenhouse, but we're in Florida and we have all the humidity and all the heat, so it's really hard to avoid that. We're also growing in the same type of system that the cherry tomatoes are growing in. As we keep on coming this way, you guys can actually see, if you stop a little bit underneath the watermelons and look down, we have eggplant trees growing across the canal. So there is another way that, or another vegetable that you can grow using the tomato tree method, or the tree method. So we have a white eggplant and a standard purple one that you are very familiar with. And so what I actually have to show you guys right in front of you are our winter melons. We are very, one of our our vegetables, one of our fruits here that has more of a wow factor. Now, if you're wondering what a winter melon tastes like, it tastes like water. It tastes like melon. It tastes like water. It's just like a melon filled with water. It's not sweet. It's not a bad taste. It has the texture of a typical melon, so the texture of a watermelon, but it tastes like water. I like to say that I think we should have been named the watermelon just because it's water. But they are called the winter melons because they're more popular in Asia, in which they would grow them in the cool, in the hotter months, and they would last all throughout the winter. And they would use these for various like stews and soups. They absorb flavors, or are supposed to, like a potato would in a soup. So that's what we use them for. I actually got to try it. It's fairly tasty, fairly starchy, much like a potato once they were cooked up. So very delicious. They do support their own weight. It is very rare that we have one drop. So we have the ropes on them to make sure that the circulation of water and nutrients is not cut off to the plant. So it's not really there to hold it up as much as it is to make sure that the winter melons will keep growing. So they will support their own weight. The watermelons and the pumpkins we grow will not support their own weight. So we have to put netted systems up under that to make sure that they hold it. To give you guys one of these, and you can pass it down towards the middle. So you can ground it up and make it into a flour or a powder. Gluten free, you can bake with it as well. And it can also be processed further into ethanol or alcohol and used to make various alcoholic beverages. But it is one of the most wonderful plants, I think, because it is one of those that you can find growing just about anywhere, or will grow anywhere, so on just about any continent. It is very drought tolerant, so it does not really fall. It's not susceptible to it. And amaranth. And so that is another one that can be used to make flour or fruit. Get over 7 feet tall, you have a green and a red variety. And directly for that, you're making something that looks quite similar to poinsettia. That is just another variety of amaranth that we are growing here. And as we come around the corner on this larger trellis up here, we are actually starting to train and grow our watermelons. And so we will be growing them very, very soon. We like to put Mickey Mouse shape molds. So we'll get Mickey Mouse shaped watermelon, and we'll also do these for our pumpkins during Thanksgiving and Halloween time. So we'll have Mickey Mouse shaped pumpkins as well. And as we come on down this way, you can peek over and there might have lemon, and right over there, there is actually one growing on it. It's so teeny tiny right now. It's going to get three times that size. So
that's crazy.
Thank you. supposed to produce one stock. So if you find one that produces more than one at a time, we'd really like to know. I'm not seeing before. But so once we have harvested the stock off of it, we then pull the tree out, and as you can see, there are smaller little banana plants growing all from the side of it. And that's how the bananas reproduce, or how we can propagate them.
The whole tree.
Yeah, so we'll take that entire tree off, and then that small one will replace it.
What is this one called?
A fluted pumpkin. Is it the one that it says it grabs onto it? It would be like the insides of